Good evening and welcome to The Big Fight, a show that is young at 21, the oldest running debate show on Indian television. I'm Sanket Upadhyay. I clearly remember in an interview in the beginning of this year, when vaccines were announced, when vaccines were cleared, on that day in an interview, Dr. Harshvardhan, who is the health minister of this country, said that this is the beginning of the end of coronavirus. It sounded very nice. We believed him. Anyone would, because the vaccines were here. Even now, it seems people have full faith in the vaccination process. But a few months on, while this vaccination drive was on, it seems that far from beginning of the end, this seems to be the beginning of a brand new wave, far stronger, far more powerful, far more infectious, spreading across the length and breadth of this country, infecting far more, killing a lot, and also the same problems that we faced last year, those problems can now be seen all over again. There is a shortage of beds, particularly in Maharashtra, which has been a perpetual pain point for over a year now. Shortage of oxygen, which has been reported by our colleagues in Maharashtra. Similar reports coming from elsewhere in the country as well. And most importantly, what was being seen as the big solution, vaccines. Now there is an obvious shortage of vaccines as well. Let us not beat around the bush. It's very clear there is a shortage of vaccines in this country. The numbers say so. We are producing about 2 million doses a day. We had started consuming about 3.5 to 4 million doses a day. There had to be a shortage. There are bound to be questions that will be asked of the government. Why was this situation not predicted earlier and action taken earlier? Did we misjudge or miscalculate our plans to fight COVID-19? That's the question which we are going to put to all our guests this evening. The question, there is a shortage of beds, shortage of oxygen, shortage of vaccines now. For the second surge, is India prepared? We're asking that question. I have two eminent panelists with me. I want to begin by introducing Dr. Randeep Guleria, the director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. We also have Niti Aayog member, Dr. V.K. Paul with us. Thank you very much, Dr. Paul. I want to begin with you, Dr. Guleria. Straight up, the first and the most pertinent question, given the circumstances that we are seeing right now, were we caught unawares with this second wave?
No, I don't think we were caught unaware. A lot of people had predicted that we would see a surge, and we have to just see how pandemics have behaved in the past. Even if you go back to the 1918 influenza pandemic, the Spanish flu, there was a huge surge in cases after the first spike. And it was again linked to the fact that people got fed up of all the lockdown and the appropriate behavior that they had to have. And they started putting the guards down. And at that point in time, we had no vaccine, there were no antibiotics. And this led to a huge surge. It's just that we're repeating ourselves. And I think it is something to do with human behavior. But I think the important thing to remember here is that when we're talking of the fight against COVID-19, although we are looking at hospitals, we're looking at COVID care centers, we're looking at ICU beds, we're looking at oxygen points. But the important part of this fight is the public involvement. And I feel that this is not a fight where science has to be involved. This is a fight where humanities has to be involved. Humanities in terms of people's behavior, in terms of getting people to follow COVID appropriate behavior, stay at home, isolate themselves, get themselves tested, is something which is more than science. Scientists have been talking for a long time. But now we need to get people who are able to influence the public to really start looking at it from a humanities point of view, because that is something that we need to do. We are really not having people who are following basic principles and thereby leading to this huge surge. If we were having more than 1 lakh cases 6 months ago, there would have been a huge concern among the public and people would have stayed at home. People would have cancelled their non-essential travel. They would have been worked from home guidelines and things like that would be happening. Nothing of this sort is happening right now. We have more than 1 lakh cases per day, and you just have to go out and it seems that people are not even bothered that we have so many cases. So we really need to work aggressively in that direction rather than trying to ramp up our oxygen beds or hospitals, because that is going to be finite. We can never match the needs unless we decrease the numbers.
No, fair enough, Dr. Guleria. Dr. Paul is also with us. Dr. Paul, the reason why I asked you these questions is because when we talk preparedness, then I am sure human behavior should also or must have been part of the government's preparedness. You know that there will be, fatigue, pandemic fatigue, vaccine hesitancy. I'm sure all of these factors must have been thought through. In that context, do you feel that the manner in which we have seen this surge and also the crisis around the vaccination process could have been better managed?
Let me respond to you, Sanket, two parts. Firstly, in terms of preparedness, and I specifically would like to mention preparedness in terms of facilities. For example, one particular empowered group has been given this task, which I chair. Way back in September, when the surge of cases was to the tune of about 90,000, before that, in fact, there was a plan for us to escalate the preparedness to the level to face a surge level of 2 lakh per day and even 3 lakh per day. So in terms of preparedness, plans and thinking behind it, it is there. That preparedness level in terms of planning is available. Last time around, we did not reach 1 lakh surge per day, and the country had preparedness at that time of 1.5 lakh surge capacity to deal with the pandemic. And as I said, we planned for 2 lakh surge as well as for 3 lakh surge. So in terms of planning, yes, there is a planning. This has been shared with the state governments. And yes, certainly when the speed of rise is of this nature, it will take a while for the implementation on the ground to take place. But in terms of thinking behind it, please be rest assured that that was potentially factored in. On the issue of vaccine, please remember, vaccination starts only when the vaccines become available. And that point came in our history, in our country, in the first week of January. What did we say at that time? That we will target the priority group in the first wave, fastest, soonest possible, and like to cover in about 7 to 8 months' time. Because no country has done it overnight. No country can do it over 2 weeks' time. There is a production that you make today, and then you use it the next week, or the next 3 weeks. So that part of planning, we are moving pretty much well. But then when you see an escalation happening with demand, because more than 45 years group has just been incorporated into the eligible group, and then you have now a situation which was, in a way, happened simultaneously, that the cases are surging. So there is an extra demand, and sometimes irrational kind of demand, over and above other tools of pandemic control. So this situation has complicated the matter, but we have to now stand together, work together to face it up. We will do systematically.
No, Dr. Paul, if I may, could you explain or elaborate when you say that there is an irrational demand for the vaccine? What do you exactly mean by that?
I mean by that that there is a certain thinking behind the use of vaccines when the vaccines are of finite supply the world over. What did the world do? That you protect your elderly. You protect those who have comorbidities. No country, barring some small countries, Israel, for example, UAE, these are small, finite, very small countries. No other country jumped on to the rationale of vaccinating everybody of the age of, let's say, 30 years or 23 years without comorbidities at all. They have only done the senior citizens by and large. And now only they are talking about covering other people. So to have a demand of this nature that don't just do this in a very general way is irrational, because then
but Dr.
the precious
Paul, demanding
commodity
more
which would
vaccine
save
and
life
vaccines becoming
not
short
in the
in
best
supply
possible manner
as of this moment according to existing rules. How are these two the same?
Say it again.
No, I'm saying that you're saying that there is a demand that you open vaccines for all. Right? Whereas the government has not done this. The government has decided it will be 45 plus, right? So you have not moved from your plan, whatever the demand may be. Yet we are staring at a shortage.
Look, there is enough vaccine for the eligible population, and this will be taken care of. Sudden increase in demand in some areas, sudden eligible population which has just come into the fold has created some level of demand which is being met at the level of the districts and within the states. Remember, center allocates the vaccine to the states. They decide where this vaccine has to go, and there is a plan behind it. Now, when there is a sudden increase in demand in some parts, or a perceived increase in demand, there can be a little bit of calibration issue. But if you go systematically, if you go systematically to cover the eligible population, there is no problem at all in terms of vaccine availability. We just have to do it better, better coordination, better clarity about the
expectations. Again, Dr. Paul, you seem to be using these technical words. You're saying that when you open it up, there will be certain calibration issues. That's exactly what one plans in advance. To calibrate according to the need.
Issue,
to that extent, were we unplanned?
No. Calibration issue is the following. We have decided as a nation, we want to cover a certain group of people with vaccination. This is to be done over a period of a certain time. Okay. Now, working together with the state government, certain vaccine number and doses are planned and are disbursed to the state. And the state has to then take it downstream to cover the eligible population. For eligible population, for planned vaccination, there is no vaccine inadequacy. But what the point that is now emerging is that when there is a sudden increase in the demand, then there is a sudden situation worsening in certain states, yes, there can be some perturbations in this. And that is where a concerted coordination and calibration is required to work together. Let's come together on that. There is no shortage of vaccine for the eligible population. That has been decided, and it will be systematically, that population will be systematically covered.
Sure, but at a time when there has been a surge, Dr. Paul, I'm sure that eventually we'll have to ramp up the production also. Very quickly, Dr. Guleri, I want to come back
That's
to you.
Happening.
Do you feel that these steps should have been taken of... Sorry?
I said the ramping up of production, we can talk about it. There are huge efforts being done. Yes, indeed.
I'm going to come back to you on that point. But Dr. Guleri, I want to bring you in. You know, we spoke to the CEO of Serum Institute, Aadhar Poonawalla, who says that, I need 3 months' time, close to 3 months' time to ramp up my production. Now, I'm just thinking aloud, had we done this, had we started this process in January, we would not have been in a situation where we're ramping up production now. We could have had more vaccines. Do you feel that opening of these targeted groups could have happened had we moved then? I mean, I know you've been the biggest proponent of asking more and more people to get vaccinated.
Yes, that's true. But I think we need to look at it from two points of view. One is, what is the capacity of industry to produce vaccines? That is something which the manufacturer has to do. They are aware of the demand, and they were aware of the demand, I would say, even 6 months ago. Because this is not only a supply for India, it's a supply for the world. So to say that now they're going to start manufacturing may not be something that we should advise. They should have been able to estimate the demand even 6 months ago. And that is something which anyone can do by just looking at the maths. What is your need for vaccination and what are the capacity that you have? So I don't think that is something that needs to be done.
He's saying I'm ready to do it, but I need financial support because it'll require finances. You know, it's a little more complicated. You're saying that he should have preempted this.
Yes, but that's what I'm trying to say. I'm not a person who could advise how he could get the financial support, but I'm sure that there would be enough investors who would be willing to support him as far as ramping up the manufacturing plant is concerned, because there was going to be a huge demand. I mean, you did have to have rocket science to tell you 6 months ago that the whole world was clamoring for vaccination and there would be huge demand. And that is why we have almost more than 50 vaccine candidates undergoing clinical trials, because people see this as not only something they're doing for humanity, but as something which has a huge market value. And that is what is happening. But the other important thing is that we need to see how we can make a good distribution as far as the vaccine is concerned. There's no shortage. But what happens is you would distribute vaccines based on what you feel is the number of people who need to be vaccinated in that area, depending on whatever census you have and people above the age of 45 or 60, whatever data you are looking at. Now, it's possible that in certain areas, because of a surge, there may be a sudden need, increased demand for getting vaccinated immediately rather than getting it done in a staggered manner. So if you were to say that people over the age of 45 are to be vaccinated, and we estimate that they would come in a staggered manner, and therefore we would have enough demand, let's say for 3 weeks, but all of them, instead of coming over a period of 3 weeks, came over a period of 2 days, it would lead to a little bit of, let's say, inequality in terms of dose available and people coming up. But one can sort of make adjustments, because there would be certain areas where there is still vaccine hesitancy and you may have more doses lying there. So if you look at India as one country and try and see how we can sort of do a fine tuning so that in the areas where vaccines are still available and not being used right now, but could be available, let's say 2-3 weeks down the line, we could have a distribution done in a way that where there is more demand, where there is vaccine eagerness, we give the vaccine, and where there's vaccine hesitancy, we try and decrease it out there so that we're able to match the vaccine demand today in certain areas.
Fair enough.
And we can cover it up later on. So that type of thing can be done. But, you know, we must understand that no one could have predicted the type of surge that Maharashtra is seeing, and therefore the type of vaccine eagerness that would have developed out there. All of us would say that, okay, you know, we would expect X number of people to come per day to get themselves vaccinated, and it will happen over a period of 2-3 weeks. Sometimes that doesn't happen. That 2-3 weeks gets compressed into 2 days. And therefore, suddenly there's an increased demand which would have sort of staggered itself over 3 weeks. So I think that is the important thing to understand. And that can be corrected within a few days. I don't see that issue become a big issue, because that will happen as a part of a panic reaction. We see that in hospitals every day.
This is exactly why Dr. Guleria and Dr. Paul... Dr. Paul, I want to come back to you. See, this is exactly why I asked you this question. Were we unplanned? Because all the points that are now being highlighted seem to stem out of lack of planning. I'm given to believe when you started speaking that, yes, we could see that, you know, there will be a rise in cases, there will be a second wave. And yet our vaccination efforts did not match, you know, the time when the second wave is going to come in. This is exactly what lack of planning will be defined as.
Sanket, according to conventional wisdom.
Correct me if I'm wrong.
Sanket, you must remember that vaccination is only one of the 5 major tools to control the pandemic and prevent the spread of pandemic. It should not be seen to the exclusion of other tools that are available to us, which includes testing, which includes containment, which includes clinical care, which includes COVID appropriate behavior, and then vaccination. No single tool is enough to control the pandemic, and therefore preparedness, if we need to talk, we must talk in all the 5 spheres. But let me respond to the fact of the requirement for financing by the companies. We got a specific proposal from SII as recent as about a week or so back. We have taken a decision on that, how to approach it, and it will be taken care of. I can say that with authority. We got a proposal from Bharat Biotech.
Can you provide more details?
Let me complete, Sanket.
If that's possible.
We got a proposal from Bharat Biotech for their Bangalore new installation, which they are repurposing for this purpose. That proposal has been examined, and we are moving forward with a certain response to that. We are there to support. Mission COVID Suraksha has 900 crore rupees available for the vaccine effort, including for moving from research to development to early production, bridging that gap. These mechanisms are put in place way back in March as part of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So the mechanisms are available. We are in negotiation. We got proposal, as I'm repeating it again, from SII as recent as only about a week or 10 days ago. And we were examining it. We were talking to each other. And let me assure you that Serum is not, you know, short of funds on their own. But yes, indeed, help must extend. They have their own intrinsic difficulties in expanding beyond a point. And they do take their own time. And remember another thing. For a company of the size of Bharat, and they told us this, for them, prior to January, when the licensure has not taken place, how much planning and how much risk taking can they do? It has to be seen in perspective, Sanket. This vaccination, who knew that the vaccine would be successful? So everything has to be taken into account. I assure you that to take care of the 90% of mortality related to COVID-19, which is the first priority and the first objective of vaccination, this will be done. This is on track. This has taken into account our ongoing production, the front-loaded production, and we have to go like that. No country has, 1 billion doses on one fine morning. That's not how it is working in this pandemic.
And Dr. Paul, just towards the end, we can't put all our eggs in one basket. Obviously, there is also talk that you will keep into consideration other vaccine candidates also. Do you feel that now is the time where the drug controllers or the agencies must sit down and evaluate whether this option should also be considered?
We are doing that on a daily basis. We are very close for licensure of the Sputnik vaccine. Almost all the formalities have been done. There are 5 manufacturing units to whom they have decided to have tech transfer. We are
ready
to support.
Can I ask for a timeline? By when can we expect this, sir?
We can expect the earliest Sputnik availability as early as May. We are trying very hard to get that. And we are at it. We are pursuing Cadila Zydus vaccine. Third phase is proving well. The vaccine has to prove to a point to be useful. You cannot unleash vaccines which are unprepared. You know about the Quad agreement in which Johnson & Johnson vaccine will be available, which is single dose vaccine. We are trying to prepone to from July to June to May as much as we can. And likewise, the expansion, significant expansion for Covaxin in our public sector organization facilities, such as Vibcol, such as the Hafkin Institution, such as Indian Immunological Limited, in addition to Bharat's own facilities, are being done. But please remember, the company would take this kind of initiatives and risks only when things start to move. They are also in touch with some private players for collaborative work.
Okay. All right. Dr. Paul, as well as Dr. Guleria, thank you very much for answering these questions. The only purpose behind me asking in great detail is so that the country gets these details, because right now there is a feeling that we were not perhaps as prepared as we should have been. You've explained in great detail. Now let's see if our viewers agree or disagree with it or not.
Sanket,
thank you very much, Dr. Guleria, as well as Dr.
Paul.
More
than any other country, both for vaccine and for all other tools. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Paul and Dr. Guleria. I also have Dr. Swati Piramal, Zahavia Khurakiwala with us, and Dr. Naresh Trehan. Thank you very much. I wanted to ask you, we'll begin with you, Dr. Trehan, first. You must have heard this conversation that we were having with the two doctors. I want to ask you, what is your assessment as far as the way we are tackling this crisis? I mean, the manner in which this sudden surge has happened, and what can be the best way? Yes, we do expect people to follow COVID-appropriate protocol, but then, that will happen when it happens. Beyond that, as far as a government system is concerned, how do we handle it?
So, Sanket, it's very clear. The first line of defense has always been, will always be, and is the most urgently needed first line of defense is the COVID appropriate behavior. There's no diluting that. The whole country should behave like we are in personal lockdown. That means personally we have to behave responsibly. That's the only way to break the chain. What did lockdown do? Lockdown broke the chain. We can do it voluntarily ourselves as intelligent citizens, be responsible, use the behavior to its ultimate, because today it seems like the virus is much more infective, not as lethal, but much more infective. So that's one part you cannot go away from. Second is the point that testing has to be ramped up to previous levels or even more, because we need to identify where the spread is the most and try to contain it at that level. The third important thing is vaccination. And from vaccine hesitancy, because of this surge, there has been vaccine eagerness. The point is, you had this long discussion about what could have been done and what is done or not done. That those are things that you have left, you have already discussed. So we will leave it for the viewers to understand what actually happened.
But Dr. Piramal, I want to come to you and perhaps ask the same question. You know, there is a lot that is said about preparedness. We took our own sweet time preparing each and every aspect of how the vaccination is going to take place, even before the vaccine candidates could complete their efficacy studies in India as well as abroad. And yet you have a situation right now where terms like calibration is used. Do you think that these can be brushed aside as just niggling issues? Or did we actually not calculate, the demand and supply, which is extremely crucial right now?
Sanket, I've been a member of the pharmaceutical industry for many years, and nobody can make 300 million doses in a few days. Nobody can predict which vaccine candidate will be successful. Nobody can predict which kind of antibodies you're going to get and which kind of mutants are rising. So how do you make a vaccine candidate against a possible mutant which may arise later on? So I think the manufacturing challenge is not trivial. It is often not seen on TV and even by the government, who thinks that the government is solely responsible for the vaccine. It isn't. It's the private pharmaceutical industry, two of which are struggling to make vaccines for the national demand all of a sudden. And even then, they really made the bet even before the vaccine was efficacious, the Serum Institute, I'm saying. They invested in the manufacture. It was just lucky for us that these two companies made vaccines even before COVID. They made it for the whole world, and therefore they had the manufacturing capacity. And similarly, in other medicines like Remdesivir, I think we are very lucky. In our country, we don't have a shortage. A few supply chain shortages, but really production shortage of mostly medicines which are not available in many parts of the world. When I smile, I see my American colleagues who are doctors there, who are my classmates, and they don't have access to so many medicines that we do. So it's very interesting that the pharma industry is stepping up. It is not a trivial challenge. It is not, you must remember that vaccines are biologicals. You can't just quickly make generics like aspirin. They have to be time tested. They have to be very good quality. Otherwise, you start getting side effects. In fact, some of the side effects are probably because of not good manufacturing. And so in Europe, as you see. So I think that we should not underestimate the manufacturing challenge by the private sector. And in fact, hats off to them that they are managing to meet the country's demand in all walks of life, not just vaccines, but medicines, oxygen, for example. Other countries don't even have enough oxygen facilities. So, you have to think about that.
Sure. No, absolutely. Nobody's undermining the role of the pharmaceutical industry, the people manufacturing the vaccines. I'm just saying the key word over here is planning. And I think you have addressed that point where you say that, there are limitations. My only point was that now that the Serum Institute says that we need about a 87-day period to ramp up our production, had we begun in January, we would have been in a better position right now. That's the only point. And thus the key word, planning, comes in. Dr. Trehan, I believe, is now back with us. Dr. Trehan, sorry, we lost you briefly. Yes, Dr. Piramal, I'll come back to you. Dr. Trehan. You were saying, sorry, sir, we lost your connection.
What I was saying was the fact remains that there is a mismatch, like you have been discussing with the previous speakers also. But the basic thing is that this is a situation which has happened today because of the fact the surge is huge. Nobody predicted it to this level that it will go at three times the first surge. The basic thing now is that from hesitancy, the vaccine is now in demand and everybody has come for urgency. So Sputnik is our next hope. and the ramping up of the two vaccines already on the scene becomes very quickly. So they're all saying that it's a matter of the next 2 weeks that we have to actually be very efficient in distributing our vaccines where they are needed and where they are being used and demanded, because there's a lot of wastage. We must stop that wastage. We must identify the areas where it's not being used efficiently and divert it to areas where there is a fire burning in the numbers. So that's why I'm saying that one, management of what we have, of the stock we have, its delivery in time is one aspect to it. Hoping that manufacturers will ramp up their manufacturing and Sputnik will appear on the scene in the next week or two. Also, there are many other vaccines in the pipeline, and they will also come in May, June, whatever.
Correct.
But the point is that this is a time to tide over what we have. There's no time for blame game. This is time for efficiently delivering. Everybody's doing their bit. The private sector has also expanded its capacity. And I think we can meet the challenge. But more importantly, people must go back to their behavior. There is no excuse for that. No, nobody should say, I'll start tomorrow. Start tonight. There's no reason to actually spread the virus. No matter how much vaccine we have, if people do not bend their behavior, we will be back in the same spot. We'll be running in the same spot. So I think spread, the basic thing is the message is very clear. Behavior pattern must be adhered to.
Okay.
Okay. And then whatever rest we have to get, we'll get.
Yeah, Dr. Trehan, you know, yes, I agree with you that we have to look forward, we have to fix the problem. Just very briefly, I mean, you mentioned right now that nobody knew that there will be a sudden surge in the number of cases. See, the point, Dr. Trehan, that I want to understand is that the vaccination drive is not responding to the surge. The vaccination drive is following its own set protocol, that first it will be open for 60 plus, then 45 with comorbidities, then all above 45. So it's not responding to any surge, and yet there is a shortage.
No, no, that's please understand. Please understand. What is the purpose of the vaccine? We have the most vulnerable people first. If we do not vaccinate them first, the mortality and the morbidity is very high in that vulnerable group. As soon as that vulnerable group got done with and it started with the healthcare workers and the frontline workers and the elderly and comorbid, we've opened it up to 45 and above, even without comorbidities. The point is that you must look at the risk-benefit ratio of doing anything. Now, the risk for the younger people is less of mortality and hospitalization. So naturally, if you look at this pattern, is not only in India, it's all over the world. This responsible pattern of distribution has been practiced all around the world. And India has got a large population, so even 9 crore vaccines seem very small. And it is true, we need much more than the rest of the world needs. And we are hoping, and that's what the whole discussion has been going on, that could have been done better, not better, doesn't matter. We are not into the politics of vaccine. But I'm into the fact that we are here where we are. We must use our resources very carefully and most effectively, no wastage. We come down to 1% or less wastage and get the vaccines delivered. And I would urge the manufacturers also that they forget about the money will come anyway. They should try to ramp up their productions in national service right now.
I think that's a very, very important message, because a lot that is being said right now is that some amount of funds are required to ramp up production. My point is, only limited point is that these are the type of conversations that should have been happening in the month of January and not in the month of April. As simple as that. We also have Zahabia Khurakiwala. She's the managing director of Wockhardt Hospitals. Ms. Khurakiwala, I want to ask you, let's move on to another aspect of vaccination. This AstraZeneca vaccine on which Covishield is based is in the international spotlight for issues like blood clots. Now, in India, we do not have any conclusive study to suggest that, this is a possible problem. In fact, in the past, there are things that have been said that the benefits far outweigh any negatives or side effects. What has been your assessment and also you know, going forward, what comes to your mind as far as our vaccine strategy is concerned? What can be done, the solutions?
So as far as the AstraZeneca vaccine and the reporting and the recent reporting of the blood clots, I think really the issue is insignificant in terms of the benefit of the vaccine. They're very, very, you know, remote reportings of these, whether it is vaccine related or whether these are not vaccine related, these would normally occur. And so I don't think that really should, you know, create a spoke or doubt in the minds of people whether this vaccine is safe or not. I think vaccinating rapidly with Covishield and whatever vaccines are available is the need of the hour, and that is the way people should approach it and think about it. In terms of the vaccine strategy for India, of course, the present, I believe that the only way to really get over COVID and see it through is through vaccination. You know, the strain is going to keep mutating. Yes, we will get a weaker strain as it keeps mutating, but COVID will stay until we are able to vaccinate our own population and the global population at large. And, you know, India is pretty uniquely positioned in terms of its own manufacturing know-how and capabilities for vaccines. That is a very unique strength that we have as a country within India and for the emerging markets and the emerging countries. And if we really do think about this as an opportunity for India to also, that if we think about this as, you know, something that we want to invest in, whether the government puts, you know, yes, there is about 900 or 2000 crores allocated, but if the government thinks about this as furthering their investment, putting in some more money in there, the various methods to do so, and really uses, and the payback is going to be pretty fast, because the need of the vaccine is much beyond what we're seeing as an immediate need. We will always need a COVID vaccination, in the years to come. Every year it will be an annual shot or whatever is the protocol then. And so there is going to be a continuous demand. The payback will be, you know, pretty fast. And we should really look at this as an opportunity to, globally, to really provide not just vaccines to our own, to Indians and our own country, but really to, the developing countries at large as well.
Okay. Yes. Dr. Piramal, let me now quickly come back to you. One question to you and one to Dr. Trehan. Perhaps if you could tell us a little about what you have read and what you have heard about this, you know, vaccine and this whole concern about blood clots. I mean, this is not even being spoken about right now in the Indian context. And as we heard Ms. Khurakiwala also saying, that the benefits far outweigh the losses.
Yeah, so just from some personal experience, we used to make, biologicals. And biologicals, by their very nature, when they're manufactured, they may have not clean manufacturing. That means they may have proteins which adulterate a product. And therefore, it is very important to see that each factory is by itself a manufacturing unit. Not like making aspirin. You can make aspirin in 20 plants and it'll be exactly the same. Biologicals, by their very nature, are not like that. And therefore, the clots which you may see in Europe will not be the same as clots that you see in India. It's a very fundamental issue of biological manufacturing. There's a very famous case in the past where J&J, in its own two plants, had this kind of adulterated manufacturing. And they had deaths in one plant and the other plant, they were fine. So this is very well known as a side effect, and therefore biological manufacturing has to be done at very high standards. And therefore your planning, your famous planning, can't be done overnight. You have to know which mutations there are. You have to know how to make the vaccine against that type of mutation. And therefore, and you need lots of it all of a sudden. So the manufacturing of biologicals is a big challenge. And I'm sure that the Indian pharmaceutical industry was very famous for ramping it up, for making it to very high standards. We have, nearly 100 countries which we supply to all over the world. And therefore, their regulators have visited our plants. So we supply it at very, very high quality. So it should reassure people that whatever we make in India is of very high quality.
True. Okay, Dr. Trehan, my final question to you, and this I have been meaning to ask, do you think that we need to ramp up our testing for newer strains and put this information out in the public domain? This has also been a matter of great concern. You know, this sudden surge that we see, even now we do not know. I mean, when I asked the government these questions, we were told that we still do not have enough data to conclude that this is perhaps a result of new mutant strains. Those strains exist, but whether this surge is related to that or not, we do not know, or we cannot conclusively say. Do you think that should be a key focus right now?
So you see, the definitive trend has not emerged yet. There are several mutants that we have found in different places. Now, take the case of Punjab. Punjab is spreading even more rapidly. And the government's assessment over there is maybe it's that the strain that has come to Punjab from UK is actually making it happen, and that is much more rampant in Punjab than other states right now. Maybe true. But the most important thing right now is that it's for the government laboratories to ramp up the testing, collate the data, and put it out into the public domain as fast as possible, because these question marks are always on top of everybody's mind for two reasons. One, to say what should be our future in the immediate future about the vaccines, whether they'll be effective or not, or should we take it or not take it? And more importantly, is it going to give us an imprint for future mutations and future dangers that may be lurking ahead of us? So both these things need to be answered. And the best way to do it is to test as much as possible and put out the real-time data. Real-time data will help. When you talk about thrombosis, we don't know whether it's in India it's having any effect or not. I can tell you at Medanta, we have done close to 30,000 vaccinations. We have not seen it. Now, as a country, it's a small sample, but these are trends that develop over a few thousand patients, and we have not seen any thrombosis or reported. We are looking at the more risky part that we are looking from the information is that 35 doctors in Gangaram and 35 doctors or so in All India Institute have gotten infected even after the vaccine. Now, there are two separate vaccines used in two different places. That means it does not show us any trend whether the vaccine is ineffective or not. But what is the reason why it's gotten? We must investigate that. We have the sample size. If we know that is it related to mutation, we'll know very quickly, because we have a concentrated group of people in two institutions today.
Yeah.
So I think that that will be helpful
well
if real-time data comes out and we are all actually familiarized with what's going on.
Correct. Okay. Right. Dr. Trehan, Dr. Piramal, as well as Zahabia Khurakiwala, thank you very much for joining us on this discussion. It was for a reason why we did not choose to invite a political panel, because then this would have become political. I mean, we've got vaccine maitri abroad, but vaccine politics domestically, which is so unfortunate at a time like this. Everyone has to collectively fight this. But we got you experts and they spoke their mind. And I guess our viewers have a much clearer picture, hopefully, of where we are right now. Thank you very much. We're stopping for a short break at this moment. But we did speak to the Delhi Health Minister to find out what the strategy is in the national capital. Remember, apart from Mumbai, there has been an explosion of cases in Delhi as well. What's the plan? We'll tell you after a short break. All right, joining us right now is the Health Minister of Delhi, Mr. Satendra Jain. Mr. Jain, thank you very much for speaking to The Big Fight. Now, the first question is, we've seen the sudden surge in Delhi. It's happening all over the country, but in Delhi also it is a matter of huge concern. Apart from this vaccine war,
I want to ask you, how are you planning to deal with this? Do you have the systems in place?
देखिए, दिल्ली में जो पिछले एक महीने से केसेस बढ़ने स्टार्ट हुए हैं और पूरे देश में भी बढ़ने स्टार्ट हुए हैं, दिल्ली में कम होते होते 200-250 केसेस पर डे पर आ गया था और पिछले तीन महीने 100-200-300 पर रहा। अब अचानक पिछले एक महीने से धीरे धीरे बढ़ते हुए अब 7-8 हज़ार केसेस पर डे आ रहे हैं, तो ये काफ़ी चिंता का विषय है कि दिल्ली में देश की तरह बाकी राज्यों की तरह से काफ़ी तेज़ी से केस बढ़ रहे हैं। हिंदुस्तान ने अभी पूरे दुनिया के अंदर सबसे ज़्यादा केस हमारे देश में आ रहे हैं, 1,31,000 केसेस कल आए थे देश के अंदर, और दिल्ली में भी जितना पीक पिछली बार गया था 8,600 उसके आसपास केसेस दिल्ली में पहुंच चुके हैं, तो थोड़ा चिंता का विषय तो है। और जहां तक रही कि तैयारी की बात है कि दिल्ली सरकार पूरी तरह से मुस्तैद है, तैयारी के हम कर रहे हैं, लगे हुए हैं। हॉस्पिटल बेड्स का जैसे छोटा सा मैं बता दूँ आपको, पिछले 5-6 दिन में हमने 4,000 बेड इंक्रीज करे हैं और कल आदेश किए हैं जो बेड और भी बढ़ाने के लिए आदेश किए हैं, जो कि जल्दी ही बढ़ जाएंगे। आज दिल्ली में 10,800 बेड इस टाइम पर अवेलेबल हैं, उसमें से लगभग 5,000 ऑक्यूपाइड हैं और 5,700 अवेलेबल हैं।
No, but Mr. Jain, the manner in which these cases are increasing, they're spiraling, it is very clear that you will need more planning, क्योंकि इतनी ज्यादा केसेस तो आपने पिछली बार भी नहीं देखे थे, तो आपकी पिछली बार की सीख, क्या सीख इस बार काम आ रही है?
लगता है कि पिछली बारी से ज़्यादा केसेज आएंगे ऐसा लग रहा है, क्योंकि पिछली बारी जो केसेज थे उसके बराबर तो लगभग हम पहुंच चुके हैं और अभी केसेज कम होते हुए पूरे देश में कहीं भी कम होते हुए नज़र नहीं आ रहे हैं, तो देश के अंदर लगभग मोमेंट तो सब लोगों का इधर उधर आना जाना है ही, जिसकी वजह से ऐसा लगता है केसेज तो अभी थोड़े दिन और आएंगे और डेफिनेटली हम बढ़ा रहे हैं, बेड्स को भी और बढ़ा रहे हैं। पिछली बारी में और इस बारी में थोड़ा फर्क यह है कि पिछली बारी सारे हॉस्पिटल्स खाली थे जब लॉकडाउन था ना, तो अभी जो हॉस्पिटल्स हैं फुल्ली ऑक्यूपाइड थे, तो इसलिए जब ऑर्डर करने के 3-4 दिन का पीरियड रहता है, जो हमने आदेश कल किए हैं उनमें से 1,000-1,500 बेड बढ़ चुके हैं और अगले आने वाले 2-3 दिन के अंदर 3-4 हज़ार बेड और बढ़ जाएंगे, और दिल्ली सरकार ने अपने बेड भी बढ़ाए हैं अपने अस्पतालों में भी, तो तेज़ी से बढ़ा रहे हैं। मतलब अस्पतालों के अंदर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की हम पूरी कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि हर तरीके से, देखो अभी भी ऑक्यूपेंसी 50% से कम है, 50% से ज़्यादा बेड हमारे पास आज भी अवेलेबल हैं, अभी भी अवेलेबल हैं, और हम पूरी तरह से इसके प्रति जागरूक हैं कि जल्द से जल्द और भी बढ़ाएं इसको।
जी, बट मिस्टर जैन, लेट्स नाउ टॉक अबाउट द मैनर इन विच दिस इज स्प्रेडिंग। अब ऐसे लगता है कि ये जो भी नया स्ट्रेन है या जो ये सेकेंड वेव में मामले बहुत तेजी से बढ़ रहे हैं, इसमें एक बड़ी जंग छिड़ गई है राज्यों में और केंद्र में, पर्टिकुलरली इवन दिल्ली, ओवर वैक्सीन की, जल्दी से वैक्सीनेट कर दें तो उससे बात बन जाए। लेकिन केंद्र का यह कहना है कि आपको स्थिति समझ में आनी चाहिए कि इतनी ही वैक्सीन है जितनी प्रोड्यूस हो रही है और वही सब में बंटनी है। आपको लगता है कि दिल्ली सरकार राजनीति कर रही है वैक्सीन पर?
नहीं, देखिएगा, राजनीति की बिल्कुल कोई नहीं कर रहा है और करने भी नहीं चाहिए। इस टाइम लड़ाई कोरोना के साथ है, हमें सबको मिलकर कोरोना से लड़ना है, आपस में लड़ने की जरूरत नहीं है, हम बिल्कुल नहीं लड़ना चाहते, कोई नहीं लड़ रहा है। हाँ, जरूर ये हमें कि केंद्र सरकार को अपने सुझाव देते रहते हैं, हम उनसे रिक्वेस्ट करते रहते हैं, और रिक्वेस्ट करना या सुझाव देना मुझे लगता है उसको लड़ाई कहना ठीक नहीं है। हमने सुझाव दिया था कि पहले जब 60 ईयर्स प्लस के लिए किया था तो हमने कहा भी कम से कम 45 प्लस के लिए तो अलाउ कर दीजिएगा, तो शुरू में कुछ लोगों ने कहा कि भी लड़ाई हो रही है, लड़ाई नहीं, सुझाव था, उन्होंने बाद में मान भी लिया। अब हम ये कह रहे हैं कि सबके लिए अलाउ कर दिया जाए, तो सुझाव है हमारा, उनको मान लेना चाहिए और हो सकता है 2 दिन बाद मान भी लें।
Do you think, Mr. Jain, that greater coordination is required between the center and the state, particularly on the issue of vaccines? मैं ये इसलिए पूछ रहा हूँ क्योंकि ये vaccines ही एक तरीके का रामबाण इलाज दिखता है। हालांकि उसमें भी हमने देखा है कि कई सारे दिल्ली के hospitals में we have a situation where doctors who were administered the vaccine have also been detected to be corona positive. इस situation से आप कैसे निपट रहे हैं?
देखो, एक ऐसा माहौल बना कि भाई जिसने वैक्सीन लगा ली है उसको अब चिंता करने की जरूरत नहीं है। किसी ने भी आज तक ऐसा नहीं कहा कि वैक्सीन लगाने के बाद गारंटी है कि अब आपको कोरोना नहीं होगा। मेरा सबसे निवेदन है कि भाई वैक्सीन लगाने के बाद भी मास्क जरूर लगाएं। वैक्सीन अपनी जगह पर है, बचाव अपनी जगह पर है, और वैक्सीन भी लगवाना जरूरी है और मास्क लगाना भी जरूरी है।
नो, बट हियर वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट डॉक्टर्स, हम आपके अस्पतालों के डॉक्टरों के बारे, जिसको लेकर के आप भी खासे चिंतित हैं, आज मीटिंग भी हुई अरविंद केजरीवाल।
हाँ, ये चिंता का विषय बिल्कुल है ना, कि एक बार ऐसा लगने लगा था कि वैक्सीन लगवा ली तो शायद अब प्रोटेक्शन पूरा मिल जाएगा, वैक्सीन लगाने के बाद, पहले भी ये कहा गया था, वैक्सीन लगाने के बाद भी आपको कोविड एप्रोप्रिएट बिहेवियर को पालन करना है, मास्क भी लगाना है, सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग का पालन भी करना है, ये पहले से कहा गया था, सभी को कहा गया था। अब मुझे लगता है कि जैसे कुछ केसेज इस तरह के आए हैं एकदम से, दिल्ली के अंदर गंगाराम हॉस्पिटल एम्स में इस तरह के केस आए हैं, तो लोग इसके प्रति अवेयर होंगे। और मुझे लगता है पिछले 3-4 महीने जब बिल्कुल केस आने बंद हो गए थे, पूरे देश में 10,000 से भी कम केस हो गए थे, दिल्ली में 200 के करीब केस पहुंच गए थे, तो लोगों ने मास्क वगैरह छोड़ दिया, उनको लगा था मतलब कोरोना चला गया, खत्म हो गया। अब क्योंकि पिछले
एक महीने से लोग बढ़ रहे हैं, ये डॉक्टर्स हैं,
बहुत तेजी से बढ़ रहे हैं। देखिएगा, मैं सबकी बात कर रहा हूँ, डॉक्टर्स भी तो पब्लिक में ही है, उनको भी तो लगा कि भाई चलो अब तो खत्म हो गया, और किसी भी, देखो डॉक्टर तो वैसे भी इलाज कर रहे हैं हॉस्पिटल में, उनको तो ज्यादा चांसेस है ही, उनके तो इन्फेक्ट होने के चांसेस इसलिए ज्यादा है कि वो पेशेंट्स के बीच में है। अगर कोरोना पेशेंट का इलाज कर रहे हैं,
लेकिन मैं आपसे ये सवाल पूछना चाहता हूँ कि आप, क्योंकि मामले वापस बढ़ रहे हैं और अभी एक निर्देश दिया है दिल्ली सरकार ने कि स्कूल्स जो हैं वो बंद रहेंगे इन बढ़ते हुए मामलों को देख करके, ऐसे में बोर्ड की परीक्षाओं का क्या होगा, इस पर कोई रणनीति है? क्योंकि एक एक तरफ अगर इस तरीके का आदेश आता है कि स्कूल आगे के फैसले तक बंद रहेंगे, ऐसे में 10th और 12th के बच्चे कहां जाएंगे, उनके मन में डर होना लाजमी है।
हाँ, स्कूल और कॉलेजेस दिल्ली में जितने भी एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं उन सभी को नेक्स्ट ऑर्डर तक बंद किया गया है। और बोर्ड के बारे में, अभी जो दिल्ली के अंदर जो बोर्ड एग्जाम है सारे सीबीएसई के थ्रू होते हैं, सीबीएसई इसका बोर्ड है मेनली, सीबीएसई बोर्ड जल्दी कुछ ना कुछ इसके बारे में सोचेगा, विचार करेंगे।
ऑलराइट, सत्येंद्र जैन, द हेल्थ मिनिस्टर ऑफ दिल्ली, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर जॉइनिंग अस राइट हियर।
थैंक यू।